Splitting the MIDI. Okay, so before I talk about how to split it, I just want to talk about why I bought the tracks in the first place. I've got quite a big setup here with quite a few synths, an existing Dawler setup, I'd say, and I wanted a way to sequence them all together. Some of them have sequences, but they're not very good. They're step sequences. They're just a bit rudimentary. And some of them don't at all. The other thing is I like the idea of having micro timing. This will become apparent in another video I'm going to do. But and probability was another one, which is really good for generative music. These both open up the tracks, in my eyes, to make different genres of music and not just dance music. If it wasn't for them, I probably wouldn't have got it. The other reason that I got it was, I wanted to bring them all together. So essentially I could control most of everything from one central place and use it as a hub and a sketch pad. A lot of time I'll stay up late and I'll draw tracks out. And if I run out of channels, I'll just literally duplicate the pattern over to MIDI 1 and 2, knowing that when I come back to the studio, I can plug it into a microfreak or something like that. But up until this point, I haven't needed to split the MIDI. But I'll show you why I've done it. All right, so first of all, I'll talk about the actual split. So the actual split is the way I've got it plugged in. I've got the NTS-1 plugged into 1. I've got the Crave plugged into 2. I've got the Microfreak plugged into channel 3. And I've got the Modal Cross in 2 plugged into MIDI channel 2. So channel 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. That's the way I've labeled them. That's what they are on default. Okay, so what you need, right, first of all, you need, the way I've done it is 2 MIDI splitter cables. They're wire cables. I'll link in the description for both of them. You can either get a long one or you can get a short one, depending on what one is easier for you. I've got both. Okay, so the first thing is, how is it done? Okay, so a MIDI device, and over a wire, it will carry 16 channels of data. That data is filtered out from each other by channels. So just because you're using one wire, if you're sending something down MIDI channel 1 and you're doing it down a cable that splits it, if you send something different down MIDI channel 2, they won't affect each other. They're on different channels. So that's the idea behind it. That's the theory behind it. The next thing you need to do is you need to turn off your circuit. And you need to hold shift and turn it on. And you'll see that this button is green on mine. If you press that again, it will deactivate the second out and it will become a through. So you want that to be green. So you might need to press it. Press play, you're done. That is now a second out. So that's that sorted. The next thing you need to do, set the MIDI channels. So obviously you know that synth 1 is MIDI channel 1. If you go to setup, it tells you synth 2 is 2, MIDI 1 is 3, MIDI 2 is 4. So what I've tried to do is adhere to this. So I've set, I have to remember off the top of my head, but I have set synth 1 to be the NTS-1, synth 2 to be the Crave, synth 3 to be the Microfreak, and synth 4 to be the NTS-1. So for each device, all you need to do is you need to change the MIDI receive channel to be whatever you've set it to on the tracks. Now, if this is inconvenient for any reason and you want 4 to be 2, then you could make, let's say, we'll make 4 down there, we'll make 2 there, and now we want 4 to be 2. You can't choose the same one that's already been chosen by something else, so you'd have to move one out of the way first. But that's not too much of a problem generally. So now we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. We know they're set. So because my other synths are set to receive, I can now sequence them on all their retrospective channels. I turn them all on. So beyond here, once you've done this, if you go to synth 1, you'll hear the synth from the tracks. If you turn the volume down, you won't hear anything. Now, because I've been moving my circuit around, it's slightly mucked up, but essentially it will be the same. That's the micro freak. If you were to press that, that will sequence whatever you've got plugged into channel one, or whatever you've got set on channel one, or to receive it, and that will receive on channel two. If I turn this down, you should hear my NTS one. Get some volume out of it. Okay, I'm just going to check that it is the NTS one and everything's right. This is why you need to set stuff up and you need to make sure that everything's right. So I know that that's on channel 5. If I press it, I should hear something, and I don't. There we go. So now I'm sequencing the NTS1. So I can put notes in, something you can't do with the NTS1 normally. This is, like I say, this is the reason that I wanted the circuit tracks, to give these things decent sequences. Right, okay, so beyond that, now on synth 2, because I'm on synth 2, if I was to go to preset, like I would do on MIDI, and be able to choose my templates, I can't. You can't do that because you're on synth. So what it does instead is it opens up the macros for a preset. So unless they're set to the same thing randomly on your synth for some reason, they won't affect it. So what I like to do is choose the synth with the best CCs, ones that I'm going to actually be able to do something with, as opposed to ones that maybe have like 3 on their implementation chart. It's not really much good to me. The idea is that you can really take advantage of these CCs. So for example, on the Microfreak, I've got synced LFO rate, cutoff. I have got the oscillator type, and then the first 3 oscillator parameters on the Microfreak. So essentially I can choose any oscillator I want. If it's a wavetable, scan it. Obviously I've got cutoff and resonance on the standard cutoff and resonance. But having the synced LFO rate, if the patch has an LFO that is synced, I can change the speed of it on the fly, which is really nice. And you can even change the threshold or the ratio of how much that actually affects it, which is really good. So yeah, like I say, you really need to choose which two have the best CCs before you decide which ones you're going to plug into synth 1 and synth 2, and which ones you're going to plug in MIDI 1 and MIDI 2. Beyond that, you can't play. I've also got a keyboard plugged into the MIDI in of the circuit track, so if I play it and it's on the right MIDI channel, you should hear an output, but for some reason you don't. Oh, I think my keyboard's mucking about, sorry. Yeah, so if you're on MIDI channel 1 and you are to play it with a keyboard plugged into the input, no problem, and you can record that, no problem. Channel 2, it's a bit quiet, but again, it works. Microfreak, if I put it onto 3, no, it won't play through it, which maybe is an opportunity for an upgrade. I mean, even though it's actually playing the notes, you can see the notes on the tracks, but it won't transmit it. And the next one is the modal. Now with this one, the same thing. Again, you can see the notes, but it won't transmit it. But the modal's got a trick. If you open up its software, which you'll probably see in the corner me waving it about, now I can minimize it. But now I can play the modal. Which leads me to think that you could probably just get Ableton to work as a through in the background. But then you've got to ask yourself, is it still doorless? That's one caveat that comes with that. That is it. I've got another video coming out about how to upgrade the circuit tracks, and the hint is it's connected to the red wire. But other than that, like and subscribe, guys, and hopefully you found this useful, and I'll do more. Thanks for your time.